Rise up and pray together. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you at this time. We bless your name, Lord, because we know that Jesus died on the cross of Calvary for everyone. I will pray, Lord, the benefit of Calvary will come to everyone in Jesus' name. Oh Lord, we pray for our soul, for our spirit, for our body. We pray for our families. We pray for everyone. We pray for all the members, all the workers, and all the invitees that, Lord, everything you did on the cross of Calvary, you're going to give us all the benefits in Jesus' name. We pray, Lord, as we open the pages of the scripture, the Holy Ghost himself will lead us into the depth of the teaching of the truth of the word in Jesus' name. Make us strong. Make us bold, make us courageous, make us victorious, and grant us, Lord, because of Calvary, grant us everything you bought for us on that cross in Jesus' name. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said, amen. Thank you very much. We're looking at Philippians chapter 2. We're considering a special message today, and that is from crucifixion to coronation. We're looking at Jesus Christ, and we could have started from where Isaiah started. He started from the conception. He said, unto us a child is born. A virgin shall conceive and be with child, and that child is born, a son is given unto us. He just went from the cradle, and he went to the cross. And then now, we're going from that cross, and we're going to the time of his coronation. As we look at the Lord Jesus Christ and what he did, as we look at the price he paid, as we look at the sacrifice that he made for us, as we look at the great things that he has provided for every child of God, and you trace everything step by step, he has given us a chance, he has given us a privilege, he has given us an opportunity that we will identify with him. Identify with him, because he was crucified, we identified with him. He died, we identified with him. He was buried, we identified with him. He rose again, we raised also, we identified with him. And then he lived a life that is righteous, a life that is pure, a life that is victorious. We identified with him, and then he conquered death, he conquered the grave, he conquered everything, and we identified with him. And then he's ascended into heaven. He's on the right hand side of the Father. He's making intercession for us right now, and because of that intercession, we're going to be victorious in Jesus' name. I'm going to trace the path from his crucifixion to his coronation, and then as I trace all that, I want to come to declare to you that as we come step after step, stage after stage, moment after moment, from that crucifixion onto the coronation, we're identified with him. What many people know is about his humiliation. Do you remember when he was crucified? Just before that time, Judas betrayed him, and the people spat on him, and he put a crown of thorns on his head, and he said, prophet, prophesy unto us. And then they led him, he took his own cross, he carried his own cross. He fell beneath the weight of the cross. They led him to that place of the skull, to Calvary, and they crucified him. While hanging there on the cross, they said, King of Israel, and teacher, and prophet, prophesy, who is mighty in you? And then the Pharisees said, let the King of Israel come down from the cross, and will believe on him. They ridiculed him from his humiliation. But, that is not the last we see of our Savior, of our Lord, of the King of Kings, of the Lord of Lords. Not just the humiliation, that's why we're going to travel all the way from the crucifixion to coronation. We are traveling all the way from his humiliation, and we're going on to his exaltation. And then as we travel together, hand in hand with the Lord Jesus Christ, from that humiliation to that exaltation, something is going to come on you. a transformation, a kind of new life is going to come unto you in Jesus' name. And if you too, in this world in which you are, where you are living, you have felt the humiliation, you have felt the shame, you have felt the tears running down your cheeks, you have felt the pain, you have felt the kind of feeling of the crown of thorns, and this world ridicule you. They say, aha, Mama Jesus, Papa Jesus. They say, Pastor. They say, Deeper. They say this and that. And then they say some unprintable words about you. We're getting out of that this morning. We're getting out of that humiliation this morning. We're getting out of that deprivation this morning. And we're going onto that exaltation in Jesus' name. Don't get tired. I'm not going to, you know, I used to say point one, point two, point three. Today, I'm going from one to seven. I said I'm going to one to seven. You know, traveling from humiliation to exaltation is a long journey, and three steps will not do, because I'm going to take you out of that place where you are. If you feel weak now, if you feel timid now, and then you say, they put pressure on me, Pastor, look at this, Pastor, look at this, when I finish 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7, there's nothing to look at. Because we're going from the valley and we're going to the mountaintop in Jesus' name. I bring the seven things to number one, crucified with Christ. Number one, we're crucified with Christ. Number two, we're connected and we're consecrated to Christ. Because you see that connection, after you are crucified with Christ and then you are connected and consecrated to Christ, I'm telling you, there's no power on earth that can hold you down anymore in Jesus' name. And then number three, conformed to Christ, conformed to Christ. Number four is we're conquerors with Christ. How many of you want to conquer today? You have already in Jesus' name. We're conquerors with Christ. Number five, co-heirs with Christ. Co-heirs with Christ. Everything he has, we have. Everything he possesses, we possess. Everything that he owns, we own. Because we're co-heirs with Christ. Number six, commissioned with Christ. Commissioned with Christ. Commissioned with Christ. Number seven, this is it. Number seven, we're crowned with Christ. We're crowned with Christ. I'm just saying that we're not going to remain in that valley of humiliation anymore. We're going from crucifixion to coronation, because we're fully, completely identified with our Lord Jesus Christ. Number one, then, number one, what is number one? Crucified with Christ. Galatians chapter 2. Galatians chapter 2. And we're looking at verse 20. I am crucified with Christ. When you think about that, here is Paul the apostle. He said, you want to know something? I am crucified with Christ. He said, not only that my Savior was crucified, not only that my sin was hung there on the cross, not only that my shortcoming is right there on the cross, my totality, everything I used to be, the things that were bad, the things that were evil, the things that were corrupt, the things that were defiling, everything you can say of my past, everything is there on the cross. Thank God I am free. Thank God you are free. I said, thank God you are free. And then he said, I myself now. He said, the real me, as I came out as an offspring of Adam, as an offspring of Eve, as I came out from all my forefathers with all the shortcomings and depravity that I carried into this world, everything is crucified with Christ. Then he says, nevertheless I live. There is a new me. There's a renewed me. There's a resurrected me. There's a risen me. There's a glorified me that now lives. The old is crucified. The real me of the past crucified. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. Christ liveth in me. It's not the Christ that walked the shores of Galilee that is living in me. It's not the Christ of Nazareth that liveth in me. It's the Christ of Calvary, and the Christ of resurrection, and the Christ that is glorified, and the Christ in power, and the Christ in glory, and the Christ in authority. When he rose from the dead, he came to the people, to his own people, and he said, all power in heaven and on earth is given unto me. That Christ with all power now lives on the inside of me. That's the implication of me being crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I. What I do now, it says, I do by an extra power. Supernatural power, heavenly power, a kind of godly power. That's why it says Christ liveth in me, and the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Praise the Lord. I said, praise the Lord. Look at the implication of that. Galatians chapter 5, verse 24. And they that are Christ have crucified the flesh. They that are Christ's have crucified the flesh with the affections and the lusts. It's telling us, you know, before we, you know, became Christians, and before, even after you became a Christian and you didn't know your right in Christ, your identification with Christ, you will, you know, at the end of the year, you will kneel down, you make a lot of resolutions to say, I'll never do this, I'll never do this, I'll never do that. And then the flesh will just be looking at you. And then after January 1st, January 2nd, you do that thing again, you say that thing again, then you slap your mouth. Then you say, did I tell you to say that again? And then it may be January 5, you say to you slap your mouth, all the slapping your mouth and the struggling, all that did not take it. But when you identified with Christ, when he lives in you and you live in him and you live by him, it says that the people who belong to Christ, all the lost, all the affections are totally crucified. And I'm praying today, I believe, I accept today, all that loss, all that affection, everything is crucified in Jesus' name. Chapter 6, I'm reading from verse 14. Chapter 6, verse 14. But God forbid that I should glory save in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me. The world is crucified unto me. Before you really knew about this, the world appeared attractive. All the Olympics and all their games appeared attractive. All their nightclubs appeared attractive. All their drunkenness appeared attractive. All their smoking appeared attractive. All their women, all their ladies, half dressed or almost naked, they appeared attractive. All their theaters, everything appeared attractive. But now, identified with Christ in his crucifixion, and it says, the world is crucified unto me. And there's nothing to desire there. My mind is not there. Your mind is not there. Your heart is not there. My heart is not there. Our affection is no more there. Because it says the world is crucified unto me. All those things of the world. That's why we're told in 1 John chapter 2. Reading from verse 15. 1 John chapter 2. All the lust of the eyes. All the pride of life. All those attractions of the world, they become distractions now because they're no more interesting unto you. Look at that. Look at that. In 1 John chapter 2, I'm reading here from verse 15, love not the world. Why would I love the world? It's already crucified unto me. And then he says, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, all their chatter, all their games, all their immorality, all their evil, all their drunkenness, all their dresses, everything. It says all that's in the world, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world passeth away, the passing fashions of the world. All those things were crucified unto them and the laws thereof. But he that doeth the will of God abideth forever. Abideth forever. We will abide forever. I said we're going to abide forever because we are crucified with him. It tells us in Romans chapter 6, I'm looking at verse 6. Romans chapter 6, we're looking at verse 6. In Romans chapter 6, reading verse 6, it says, knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. Henceforth, because the power of the cross has worked in our lives, we'll not serve sin in Jesus' name. Number two, we're connected with Christ and we're consecrated unto Christ. Connected and consecrated unto Christ is telling us now that because of that first step, he died for me. And because I'm totally identified with him, crucified with him, I'm connected with him. Crucified with him, I am consecrated unto him. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, I'm reading from verse 14. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, and we're reading from verse 14. Here is what it says in verse 14. It says, for the love of Christ constraineth us, because we must judge that if one died for all, then we're all dead. That is, he died for me. Therefore, I'm dead to the world. I'm dead to their noise. I'm dead to their invitation. I'm dead to all the practices, all the pranks they play. I'm dead to all their tricks. I'm dead to all their temptations. I'm dead to all their trials. I'm dead to all their persecutions. He says, because if one died for all, then we're all dead. Then it says, and that he died for all, that they which live should not live henceforth unto themselves. That is, it's no more my will, it's his will. It's no more my way, it's his way. It's no more what I like, it's what he loves. It's no more what I desire, it's what he desires. You're no more living for yourself, you are connected with him. You are consecrated unto him. That is the evidence you are a child of God. That's the evidence you understand Calvary. That's the evidence you understand what Christ has done and what you ought to be and what you ought to do for the sake of the Lord. Then it says that, but unto him that died for them and rose again, it says, he tells us right there, because he died for us, now we're totally dead. We're totally dead unto the things of the world. On his behalf, we're now living. We live like he wants us to live. We're looking at Romans chapter 6. Romans chapter 6. I'm reading from verse 13. Neither yield ye your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin. Because now, you know, the pleasure you used to derive in sin, the pleasure is no more there. The knowledge of the word makes sin distasteful. The knowledge of the word of God makes pleasure, the pleasure of the flesh, distasteful. And the knowledge you have, it will give you sorrow if you go back into sin. It will give you heartache if you go back into sin. It's like poison entering your system. It will make you sick. It will make you like, what are you living for? You become like a nobody, like a non-entity. And then all your self-esteem is gone. Because of that, you say, no, it cannot be. All my members now, because I'm connected with Christ and I'm consecrated unto Christ. It says, neither yield your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead. And then your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. Instruments of righteousness unto God. Instruments of righteousness unto God. You are consecrated to Christ. In 1 Corinthians chapter 6. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 19 and 20. What? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which ye have of God, and ye are not your own? It says, don't you know? Don't you realize? Don't you accept? Don't you believe that your body is now the temple of the Holy Ghost? Look at this connection we're seeing. Because you now come to the Lord, because the Lord now wants to dwell inside you, he wants to live inside you. He says the Lord is not just in the cathedral, the Lord is not just in the tabernacle, the Lord is not just in the temple, in you right there. He has relocated and he makes your body now the temple of the Holy Ghost. And because of that connection, and because of that identification, that's why now you are totally yielded unto the Lord. It says, for ye are bought with a price, in verse 20. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which belong to God, which are God's. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, 1 Corinthians chapter 10, we're reading there, 1 Corinthians chapter 10, we're looking at verse 31. It says, whether therefore ye eat or drink. You see, when you're identified with Christ, every area of your life is now affected by that identification with Christ. Where you go, who you visit, who you relate with, who you interact with, and the houses of merriment or whatever that you used to visit, everything now you're going to measure with the word of God. Will Christ do this? Will Christ go there? Will Christ behave like this? Will Christ act like this? There's a total identification. That's why it says, whether therefore ye eat or drink, or whatsoever ye do, do all to the glory of God. Colossians chapter 3, verse 16. In Colossians chapter 3, verse 16, it says, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. Verse 17, and whatsoever ye do, in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by him. That's connection with Christ and consecration unto Christ. In verse 23, whatsoever ye do, do it heartily, as to the Lord and not unto men. Not unto men. First of all, not unto yourself. Second, not unto men or women around you. You're not doing anything because of brother so-and-so, because of sister so-and-so. You're not serving the Lord because of your husband, because of your wife. You're not following because of your parents or because of your children. You're not doing a favor to anybody. You're saying because of the Lord, because of the Lord, because of the Lord. Because the Lord died for me and I'm identified with him. Because of that, here is what I do. Here is where I go. Here is how I comport myself. Here is how I conduct my life. It says over there, whatsoever ye do it heartily, as to the Lord and not unto men. Number three, conformed to Christ. Conformed to Christ. You see, as Christ came, as he went to the cross and died for us, he says, there is one thing I'm looking for. It's not just a mere conversion. Some people say, I'm converted to Christ. That's great. That's wonderful. But you see, that conversion should have a goal, a purpose. It is to make us conformed unto the Lord in the might of the Father. He wants to have many, many sons and daughters like his only begotten son. In the mind of Jesus Christ, our Lord, he wants to have all the people that are following him to be exactly like him. In the mind of the Holy Ghost, he wants to take every new creature and he wants to mold you. He wants to mend you. He wants to touch your life. He wants to adjust your life. He wants to transform you until you look like the Lord Jesus Christ, conformed unto Christ. Conformed unto Christ. We're looking at Romans chapter 8. In Romans chapter 8, I'm reading from verse 29. Romans chapter 8, we're reading from verse 29. For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his son. to be conformed unto the image of his son. That already shows you the goal that the Lord wants to take you to. And once you identified with Christ, you put your hand in his hand. And then your heart is with him. Your life is with him. Your desires are for him. You're no more thinking about yourself, what I want, what I desire, what I prefer, what I would like. No, the consideration now is the Lord and the Lord alone. And because it's the Lord and the Lord alone, and you know the goal of the Father, you know the purpose of the Father, you know the desire of the Father. He wants every child of God. He wants every convert in the kingdom. He wants every believer believing on the Lord Jesus Christ to be conformed unto the image of his son. Chapter 12 of Romans. Romans chapter 12. I'm reading from verse 1. I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies. Ye present your bodies. You know, there are many people, they don't understand that. And you know, they have this kind of partial knowledge of the word of God. They say, I give my heart to Jesus. How about your body? I give my heart to Jesus. How about your tongue? I give my heart to Jesus. How about your lips? You can paint it with whatever color you want. My lips, you know, that's mine. But my heart, I give to Jesus. How about your hand? Your hand can still steal, and then your hands are sticky. Anytime you see money, money will stick in your hand. I just gave my heart to Jesus. How about the feet, your feet, where you go? I just gave my heart to Jesus. Jesus said, I need the whole thing. It's all or nothing. It says over here, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies, your body from your head to your eyes, to your ears, to your nose, to your mouth, to your tongue, and then to the things you drink and everything, and then your hands and your strength and everything that you have within you there. Present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and the perfect will of God. There we are. He's talking about our being conformed unto Christ. We live like him. We live like him. We do everything to the glory of the Father, like he would have done, like he wants to do. And he wants to take your body now to express his loyalty and faithfulness and obedience to the Father. In 1 John chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 3. 1 John chapter 2, verse 3. Conformity unto Christ. Conform to Christ. 1 John chapter 2, I'm reading verse 3. And hereby do we know that we know him, if we keep his commandments. He that says, I know him, and keepeth not his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whoso keepeth his word, in him verily is the love of God perfected. Hereby know we that we are in him. And he that says he abideth in him ought himself to walk also so to walk, even as he walked. He that says he abideth in him ought himself also so to walk, even as he walked. That's conformity unto Christ. 1 Peter chapter 2, I'm reading verse 21. 1 Peter chapter 2, we're looking at verse 21. 1 Peter chapter 2, conformity unto Christ, conformed unto Christ. 1 Peter chapter 2, here we're looking at verse 21. For even here unto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that ye shall follow his steps. You know, some people, they say, you people, why don't you smoke? What if you see a picture of Jesus Christ and then you see cigarette in his mouth? You say, this is blasphemy. Whoever drew this, whoever painted this, this is a blasphemer. You said, this is terrible. Well, if you'll not want to see cigarette in Jesus' mouth, hey, about your own own mouth. Because he that says he abideth in him ought himself also so to walk, even as he walked. You know, some of these people, they say, don't lay any rule on us here. Let us just be free and let us be free. And there are some of these young people, they're not following after the Lord Jesus Christ. They're following after the football star. But, you know, the football star, the man will weave the air as a woman. And then some boys will go and copy that, and then they still say, I'm born again, I'm saved, I'm a child of God, I have eternal life. I'm going to, hey, don't talk like that. If you saw Jesus Christ weaving the air like a woman, will you say, no, that will be blasphemy. If that will be blasphemy, how about you? Because he has left us an example that we shall walk as he walked. You know, sometimes we see some of these boys, they have a earring in one ear, or maybe in 2 ears, and then they carry Bible on the other hand, and then they go to all these so-called churches, and they're, you know, drumming for the Lord, dancing for the Lord with all the earrings there, and they'll say, hey, how are you? Or say, praise the Lord, I'm just rejoicing in the Lord, I'm celebrating the Lord. Don't talk like that. If you saw the earrings they had in the ears of Jesus, what will you say? You say, that is blasphemy. If that is blasphemy, how about you, boy there? You see, if you're going to be a child of God, be a child of God, and you are conformed unto Christ. All those things that all those people are doing, you throw everything away. You say, now I'm converted, I'm cleansed, I'm consecrated unto Christ, and I'm committed, and I'm totally yielded unto the Lord. Conformity unto Christ. Where you go, will Christ go there? How you dress, will Christ dress like that? How you think, what you are thinking about, will Christ think like that? And the things you do under cover, behind the curtain, will Christ do that? He said, I always do the things that please my Father. Do you always do the things that please the Father? He has left us an example. And he says, if you say you are in Christ, you are totally conformed unto Christ, your comportment, your character, your conduct, everything will be like Christ. It will be so in Jesus' name. I said it will be so in Jesus' name. When the power of Calvary comes on you, when the power of the crucifixion, when it has effect in you, you will never be the same again in Jesus' name. I'm looking at number 4 now. We're conquerors with Christ. We're conquerors with Christ. It says, when we come to the Lord, it's not just that, you know, I'm born again, I'm a child of God. It's more than that. What do we have in him? What do we have in him? What is it we can say, praise the Lord, since I knew Jesus Christ, look at the difference it has made in my life. Look at the distinction, because there is a distinction it has made in my life, because now I'm a real child of God. It makes you to be conqueror with him, conqueror with him. I'm looking at Romans chapter 8, and I'm reading from verse 37. Romans chapter 8, and we're looking at verse 37. Romans chapter 8, reading from verse 37, here is what it says over here. It says, nay, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. We are more than conquerors through him that loved us. The devil will come, we're more than conquerors through him that loved us. The tempter will come, we're more than conquerors through him that loved us. The temptress will come, but we are more than conquerors through Christ who loved us. And all the people of the world will come, they try to put pressure on you, and drive you to a corner, and drive you to a wall. Then you say, no, I'm going to stand, because we're more than conquerors through him that loved us. Look at verse 38. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come. He mentioned it all. Anything you can think about, maybe what if this comes, what if that comes, what if that other thing comes. It says, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. We conquer, we're conquering with him. I said we're conquering with him. That's why he tells us in 1 John chapter 4, verse 4. 1 John chapter 4, and I'm reading here from verse 4. First John chapter 4, and we're looking at it in verse 4. It says, ye have got little children. When it says little children, understand, John the Beloved wrote this at the age of 95 or 96. And when he looked at, you know, all those believers, 30 years of it before him, they were little children. And he looked at all those 40-year-old people, you know, little children, 50, 60 years. He was 95, 96 already. And then he had been with the Lord from the time Jesus Christ began to call the disciples, follow me, I'll make you fishers of men. Follow me, I'll make you fishers of men. He was one of the people that Jesus called for. And so he had followed the Lord all through that, you know, that ministry, earthly ministry of Christ. And then at the cross, after the cross, and then on the day of Pentecost, he had seen the whole book of Acts of the Apostles. He was alive when everything was done. When Paul came in, he was there. After Paul went out, he was there. Peter came in, he was there. Peter had gone, he was there. And because of his long abiding in the Lord, when he looked at everybody, not just my little children, and he's talking to all of us here, we're all his little children. I said, well, it's little children. That's why he says now to everyone in 1 John chapter 4, verse 4, ye have got little children and have overcome them, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. We're going to conquer this world. I said, we're going to conquer this world. 1 John chapter 5, I'm reading from verse 3. 1 John chapter 5, I'm reading from, why don't you back up to verse 2? By this we know that we love the children of God when we love God and keep his commandments. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous. For whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world. Whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world, and this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. Who is he? Who is he that overcometh the world, that conquers the world, that prevails over the world? It says, but he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God, we're conquerors with him. Number 5, we're co-heirs with Christ. We're co-heirs with Christ. We're co-heirs with Christ. Everything he possessed, we possess. Everything he owns, we own. When you think about that, then you understand. He has even given us his name. And he said, whatsoever you ask the Father in this name, I'm going to give unto you. Praise the Lord, you have something. I said, praise the Lord, you have something. And that thing you have will be sufficient to kind of sustain your life in every area in Jesus' name. Look at Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8, we're co-heirs with Christ. Co-heirs with Christ. We're looking at Romans chapter 8, and I'm reading here from verse 16. Romans chapter 8, we're reading from verse 16. The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. That's where some people stop. Why don't you go on? The Spirit is bearing witness with my heart. I know when I repented, praise the Lord. I know the transformation that came, praise the Lord. I know the change that came, praise the Lord. I became a new creature, praise the Lord. All things pass away, praise the Lord. All things became new, praise the Lord. My language became new, my life became new, my thoughts became new, my appearance became new, my dressing became new, everything became new. It praise the Lord. But go on, go on. Don't just say, praise the Lord. The Spirit is bearing witness with my spirit that I'm a child of God. In verse 17, and if children, then heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with him, that we may also be glorified together with him. He tells us there that we own what he owns, we have what he has, we possess what he possesses, because we're not joint heirs and we are co-heirs with the Lord. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 2. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9. The things we have inherited, the things that belong to us. That's why it says in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9, it says, but as it is written, eye has not seen, no ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of men the things which God has prepared for them that love him. It says, eyes have not seen, ears have not heard, the things the Lord has kind of prepared for you, provided for you, and given unto you. Oh, some people say that's in heaven. It's more than that. Also on earth. Look at verse 10. But God has revealed them unto us. Yes, did not hear this before. God has revealed them unto us. People did not know this before. It never entered into their minds in the Old Testament. But now it says God has revealed them unto us by Spirit. For the Spirit searches all things, yea, the deep things of God. That's what we have. That's what we have. The deep things of God. That's what we're possessed today. It's telling us in Romans chapter 8 verse 32. Romans chapter 8 verse 32. Because we're now co-heirs with Christ. Romans chapter 8 and verse 32. In verse 32 it says, he that spared not his own son, but delivered him us up for us all, how shall he not also with him freely give us how many things? Tell me out loud. All things, that's what you have inherited. And when you think about, you wake up in the morning, say, praise the Lord, I have all things. Everything I will ever desire, everything I will ever need, everything I would ever say, oh God, how about having this, how about having that? All that is provided already. Even the things that may not enter into your mind now. What do you mean by that? Eyes have not seen, ears have not heard. It's not entered into the hearts of man yet. The things which the Lord has provided for you. What does that mean? What it means is this, when you are a teenager, and the things you will need when you become 42, 43, you never even thought about that. It never entered your mind. And when you become 40, 42, 43, then all of a sudden you say, I need this, and God said, I provided that already. You didn't know about that when you are 18 or 19, because what ears have not heard, what eyes have not seen, what has never entered into your heart, I prepared it for you already. And then when you are 40 to 45, the things you will need when you're 55 to 60, you will, you know, it doesn't enter your mind. And then eventually you become 55 or 60, all of a sudden you the kind of strength you need, the kind of support you need, and the kind of provision you need, and the kind of whatever it is, the Lord said, is already there for you. Oh Lord, I didn't even pray about this when I was 45, 20 years ago, 15 years. Yes, I know, because what has never entered into the heart of man, you know, some people, they worry unnecessarily. I am 63 now, and then when I become 80, because, you know, this long life, I didn't think about long life before, but now I'm thinking of long life. I said you are thinking of long life now. But you know, I see that when people become 75 and when they become 80, I don't know what they will need at that time. I don't know I will be able to carry myself at that time. What has not entered into your mind now, into your heart now? When you become 80, all those things are available, and the Lord will satisfy you with every need, every supply in Jesus' name. That's what it says over here, because it says, he that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all. How shall he not with him also freely give us all things? All things. All things are yours in Jesus' name. In Colossians chapter 2, Colossians chapter 2. I'm reading here from verse 8. Colossians chapter 2, Colossians chapter 2. And we're looking at it from verse 8. In verse 8, this is what the word of God is saying. It says, beware, lest any man spoil you through philosophy of vain deceit, after the tradition of men, after the rudiment of the world, and not after Christ. He says, For in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. When you think about this Christ, that's why I told you, it's not like we saw him when he was betrayed. Not like we saw him when he was crucified. That's his humiliation. It's gone beyond that now. But he says, now, in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and ye are complete in him. And ye are complete in him. And ye are complete in him. Anything that is not complete in your body right now, it is supplied in Jesus' name. You know, some people said, the doctor said, I have low this, I have low that, and because I don't have enough of this and enough of that, that a baby will never come. I pray that miracle baby come fast, come fast. It's coming right now in Jesus' name. Because now I am complete. Where are you? You are complete. I said you are complete. Your heart is complete. They said your heart is smaller than usual. In the name of Jesus, that heart become normal in Jesus' name. They said the kidney is not functioning this way. That kidney be complete in Jesus' name. They say, what have you been eating? Where have you been going? It looks at the cells in your body. You know, some cells are weak and some cells are average. The cells are not complete. Brain, become complete in Jesus' name. Look at that. And it says, but ye are complete in him, which is the head of all principality and power. Thank God you are complete. I said, thank God you are complete. Ladies, thank God you are complete. Sister, thank God you are complete. And I pray that that hand of the Lord, transforming hand of the Lord, will touch you right now and make you complete in Jesus' name. Number six, we're commissioned by him, by Christ. Commissioned by Christ. Commissioned by Christ. Do you know that Jesus has commissioned us as the Father commissioned him? He sent us as the Father sent him. He gave us the same commission and the same great commission that the Father gave him. He has transferred that. He has translated that into our lives. We are commissioned with him. He says in John chapter 17 verse 18, as thou hast sent me into the world, even so have I also sent them into the world. We're commissioned like him. We're commissioned by him. We're commissioned with him. We're commissioned like him. Like him. As thou, Father, hast sent me into the world, even so I sent them into the world. And we're commissioned by him. I sent them into the world. And we're commissioned with him, because it is exactly what he was sent to do here. That is what we're supposed to be doing. Now, chapter 20 of John. John chapter 20 verse 21. John chapter 20 verse 21. Then said Jesus unto them, peace be unto you. Peace be unto you. I said, peace be unto you. As my Father have sent me, even so send I you. We're commissioned with him. We're commissioned by him. And we're commissioned like him. In fact, we're told in 2 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, I'm reading here from verse 20. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 20. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God did beseech you by us. We pray you in Christ's stead, be ye reconciled to God. Be ye reconciled to God, because we have that commission. We go everywhere now and we're telling people, reconcile with God. Don't be an enemy to God. Don't fight against God. Don't set your will against God. Don't set your way against God. Don't set your mind against the mind of God. Align with the Lord and be conformed unto the way of the Lord. Reconcile, turn away from your sin and turn unto the Lord, and let the Lord himself take you in as a real child. He says, now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God did beseech you by us. We pray you, will plead with you in Christ's stead. That is, we're standing in the place of Christ now, because his commission is a commission. His commitment is a commitment. What he committed himself to, the Son of Man is come to seek and to save that which was lost. That's what we're committed. We have committed ourselves to in Christ's stead. Be ye reconciled unto God. And we have the same kind of devotion to that commission that Jesus Christ had, because he said in John chapter 4 verse 34. John chapter 4 verse 34. Here is what the Lord said, and this is to be true of us. If it was true of Christ, it must be true of us. It must be true of us. John chapter 4 verse 34. Jesus saith unto them, my meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work. My will is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work. Now, if you have not even started, how do you finish what you have never started? Some people, after they say they came to the Lord Jesus Christ, I'm born again, I'm a child of God, he has healed my soul and healed my spirit and healed my body, He's made a change in my life. He has transformed me. Have you ever told anybody, go home to thy friends and tell them what he has done for you? How you are reconciled with God, how the enmity was cancelled, how the wall of partition was broken down, how you repented, how you believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, how salvation, with the joy of salvation and the victory that comes with salvation came into your soul. Go tell them, go and tell them, go and tell them that Jesus died for sinful man. Go and tell them he's coming again. That's what he's saying over here, that that was his zeal, his meat, his passion, what induced him, what excited him. And we're to do the same thing. You have to have that same kind of zeal and that kind of enthusiasm. You should be able to say, like Jesus said, my meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work. We're looking at chapter 9 of John. John chapter 9, and we're looking at verse 4. John chapter 9, verse 4. It says, I must work. I must work. I must work. Do you feel a compelling power like that upon your soul? A compelling power like that upon your spirit? Do you feel compelled to say, I must? I must. Whatever others do, I must. Whatever others don't do, I must. I must work the works of him that sent me while it is day. The night cometh when no man can walk. John chapter 13. In John chapter 13, I'm reading from verse 16. John chapter 13, we're looking at verse 16. It says, verily, verily, I say unto you, the servant is not greater than his Lord, neither is he that is sent greater than he that sent him. He has sent you, he has sent me, he has sent us. It says in verse 20, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that receiveth whomsoever I send, receiveth me, and he that receiveth me, receiveth him that sent me. We're commissioned with him. We're commissioned like him. We're commissioned by him, Christ. Number 7 now, crowned with Christ. Crowned with Christ. You know, as you meditate on all this thing that the Lord is saying about the steps and the points and the reality of our identification with the Lord, you'll never be the same again in Jesus' name. Crucified with Christ. Connected and consecrated to Christ, conformed unto Christ, co-heirs with Christ, and commissioned with Christ. Now we're crowned with him. We're crowned with him. You reign with him in Jesus' name. It tells us in Hebrews chapter 2. Hebrews chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 9. Hebrews chapter 2, we're reading from verse 9. We are crowned with Christ. Crouch with Christ. Crouch with Christ. Let's see Christ in Hebrews chapter 2 and here in verse 9. It says, but we see Jesus, who is made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crouch with glory and with honor. We see Christ. We see Christ. We see Christ crowned with glory and crowned with honor, that he by the grace of God should taste death for every man. And then he tells us in Romans chapter 5. Romans chapter 5. Here we're reading from verse 17. Romans chapter 5, verse 17. It says in verse 17, for if by one man's offense death reigned by one, much more they which receive abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one Jesus Christ. We're going to reign in life. I say we're going to reign in life. Reign, Master Jesus. Reign, Master Jesus. In my home, reign, Master Jesus. In my heart, reign, Master Jesus. In my life, reign, Master Jesus. On my job, reign, Master Jesus. On the road, reign, Master Jesus. We want him to reign in us. And when he reigns in us, we'll reign with him too in Jesus' name. We're looking at verse 21. Verse 21, that has seen us reign unto death. Even so, my grace reign through righteousness unto eternal life by Christ Jesus our Lord. You will reign with him in Jesus' name. Here on this earth, we're reign with him. And then when we get to glory, wonderful, wonderful, we're going to reign with him too. We're looking at Revelation chapter 3, verse 11. Revelation chapter 3, verse 11. Behold, I come quickly. Hold that fast which thou hast, that no man take, that no man take thy crown. You have a crown, you are going to reign. I said you have a crown, you are going to reign. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 6. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 6. Where you are now, what you have now, what you possess now, the glory in your life right now, because of this step-by-step identification with the Lord. Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 6, and he has raised us up together and made us to sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. He has raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Heavenly places in Christ Jesus. You are reigning, you'll keep on reigning in Jesus' name. Before we pray, we're looking at some age. Before we pray, we're looking at some age. And I'm reading from verse 3. It says, when I consider thy heavens, the works of thy fingers, the moon and the stars, which thou hast ordained, what is man that thou art mindful of him? The Lord is mindful of you. And all this that we have said, he prepared everything for you. And the psalmist said, I'm surprised. He said, what is man that thou art mindful of him? And the son of man that thou visitest him? For thou hast made him a little lower than the angels. The conclusion of it is, if you have come to Christ, if you are crucified with Christ, if you are connected and consecrated to Christ, if you are conformed unto Christ, if you are seated in heavenly places with Christ on the throne, if you are conquering with Christ, if you are concrossed with Christ, if you are co-heirs with Christ, if you are commissioned with Christ, if you are crowned with Christ, you are just a little lower now here on this earth than the angels. For thou hast made him a little lower than the angels and hast crowned him with glory and honor. Crowned you with glory and honor. Thou has made him to have dominion over the works of thy hand. Thou hast put all things under his feet, all sheep, all oxen, yea, and the beasts of the field, the fowl of the air, and the fish of the sea, and whatsoever passes through the parts of the sea. O Lord, our Lord, O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is thy name in all the earth. How excellent is thy name. When you take what belongs to you, then the people of the world will see how excellent the name of the Lord is. Change your thinking, change your mindset, change your attitude, change what you think about yourself, and change what you say about yourself. Understand, number one, say this with me: I am crucified with Christ. Number two, I am connected to Christ. I am consecrated to Christ. I am conquering with Christ. I am conformed unto Christ. I'm a co-heir with Christ. I am commissioned with Christ. I am crowned with Christ. Live like that every day. You'll never know defeat in Jesus' name. Rise up and let us confess that before the Lord. Let us confess that before the Lord. Let us live like that too. Let us live like that too. Here is what you are. Here is what you have. Here is what belongs to you in the Lord. Open your mouth and tell the Lord, go through one by one, and say, this is mine. This is mine. This is mine. Crucified with Christ. Connected and consecrated to Christ. Conformed to Christ. Conquering with Christ, co-heirs with Christ, and commissioned with Christ, and crowned with Christ. Tell the Lord, praise the Lord for what he has done for me. Praise the Lord for who I am in Christ. Praise the Lord for what I have in Christ. This is what you are. This is what you have. Believe it. Believe it. Believe it. Accept it. Talk like that. Think like that. Live like that. Behave like that. Conform yourself like that.